Good morning.
I invite you to stand and join responsively in our call to worship. How good and pleasant it is
when sisters and brothers live together in unity.
It is like the precious oil anointed on the forehead,
running down the collar of the priest's robe.
It is like the dew of Hermon,
falling on the mountains of Zion.
For there the Lord has ordained God's blessing, life and peace and blessing forever.
Please join me in the unison prayer of confession. Almighty God, we gratefully acknowledge that you have not dealt with us according to what we deserve, but according to your mercy. We have taken your forgiveness for granted. We have been unkind to our brothers and sisters. Forgive our ingratitude. Extend your kindness towards us again. Fill us with your Spirit so that all our words and actions may glorify you. May we fully enjoy your goodness and share your goodness with the world around us. May we give glory and honor to Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And now a moment for silent personal confession. Amen. When we were dead in our trespasses, God made us alive together in Christ. By grace we have been saved. God forgave all our sins and erased the record against us under the law. God set aside our transgressions, nailing them to the cross. God has restored to us full faith and full fellowship through the mercy that comes through Christ. Friends, believe the good news is still good. In Jesus Christ, we are. Through faith in Christ, we are offered life in the Spirit.
The fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, and patience.
The fruit of the Spirit is kindness, generosity, faithfulness, gentleness, and self-control.
If we live by the Spirit, let us also walk in the Spirit.
The peace of Christ is alive and at work in this congregation. The peace of Christ be with you all. Prepare our hearts, O God, to accept your word. Silence in us any voices but your own, so that we may hear your word and also do it through Christ our Lord. Amen. Our scripture lesson today is from Genesis 45, verses 1 through 15. Joseph provides for his brothers and family. Then Joseph could not control himself before all those who stood by him. He cried, "Make everyone go out from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept aloud, so that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. And Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, for they were dismayed at his presence. So Joseph said to his brothers, "Come near to me, please." And they came near. And he said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are yet 5 years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. And God sent me before you to preserve for you a remnant on earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and ruler over all land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not tarry. You shall dwell in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you, your children, and your children's children, and your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. There I will provide for you, for there are yet 5 years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have do not come to poverty. And now your eyes see, and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see, that it is my mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father of all my honor in Egypt and of all that you have seen, "Hurry and bring my father down here." Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept. Benjamin wept upon his neck, and he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. After that, his brothers talked with him. The word of God for the people of God.
Shall be a day when the watchman upon the mountaintop shall cry aloud, "Arise ye, arise ye, get ye up unto Mount Zion, to the Lord your God. For thus saith the Lord, fear ye not, O Israel, neither be thou still dismayed. Refrain thine voice from weeping, and thine eyes from tears. For I, the Lord, am with thee, and will save. Fear not, O Israel, neither be
The drought was in its third year. The famine was chronic. With little grain or food, Jacob sent his sons down to Egypt in hope for help from the Pharaoh. And there they found a ruler who showed interest in their plight, a ruler who was sympathetic toward them and understood them. He was the one they beat up and put in a pen, but they didn't recognize him. He was the one they sold into slavery, but they never imagined it was him. The one who rose up to become chief of Pharaoh's empire. And he said, "I am your brother Joseph. I am your kin, your own flesh and blood." The brothers cringed, expecting punishment. They feared retaliation for the judgment they deserved. They expected the violence that they had put on him to be reciprocated. Instead, Joseph's verdict was mercy, forgiveness, grace. Is forgiveness credible? Is forgiveness possible? Is forgiveness practical? One writer laments that Joseph should have let his brothers have it with both barrels. He should have confronted them, sat them down, and made them confess their wrongs. He never held their feet to the fire and made them admit their sin and guilt. Instead, it appears Joseph does all the emotional work and heavy lifting to restore their relationship. Whenever we sustain a wrong, the Bible offers us two ways to piece our relationships back together. One is called interpersonal reconciliation. To sit down with the person and say, "There's been a misunderstanding. What you said slighted me, or what you did hurt me." And then you talk it through. Reconciliation is a sign of hope that two people can work through the pain inflicted. Reconciliation is an acknowledgement of wrongs committed and a commitment to change one's attitude and actions in order to go forward in the future. Many of you remember the Truth and Reconciliation Commission in South Africa. When the African majority came into power, they were crying for harsh sentences to repay those who had committed crimes of the state. But Archbishop Desmond Tutu said, "This method is not restorative justice because it has no love for the white Afrikaners." So he proposed a commission which would listen to the leaders and soldiers from the apartheid government, testify under oath about the atrocities they had committed, hear them explain their abuses of human rights, the acts of violence which decimated people and communities for generations in order to keep the public order. The confession gave the perpetrators of crime an opportunity to relieve themselves of guilt that weighed heavy on their shoulders. But more importantly, these hearings gave those who had been victims of crime and repression and oppression, the family members of those who had been hurt, an avenue to express their hurt and their anger, to get it out. And then the commission forgave the wrongdoers. Each person received a document that absolve them of their wrong and set them free. A spirit of reconciliation took over the land that had a lasting effect so that people could work together to create a new society. Many are saying a similar process needs to happen on a large scale here in the United States as it has in Canada. A national conversation to seek reparations and work toward reconciliation as we come out of the after effects of slavery. The other form of reconciliation is called intra-psychic forgiveness. You have to change your own thoughts and feelings. You have to make a continual mental adjustment in order to let forgiveness flow. Actions in the past cannot be changed. The further hurts are in the rearview mirror, the more difficult they are to deal with now. Hostilities for past events need to lose their stranglehold on our souls. Yesterday's hurts can keep us from living into today's joy. Perhaps while Joseph was in bondage and servitude as a slave, he realized just how dear his family was to him. Here Joseph demonstrates that he has the spiritual presence of mind and the spiritual magnitude of heart to forgive his brothers, to let the past remain in the past. I'm your brother, Joseph. I want to see my father again. I want to hold and kiss his neck. I want to cling to my brother Benjamin. No matter what happened, I want to be family again and start all over again. To be one. Forgiveness is a sign that your heart is disposed to love. Augustine wrote that love always has to have as its object something or someone worthy of love. And often it's the one closest to you, your sister and brother, that needs love and forgiveness the most. Is forgiveness absolute? Is forgiveness always the best way? Well, that's for you to say. We've seen models of forgiveness and reconciliation in the past couple of months. I believe forgiveness is not mandatory or compulsory, but has to do with the situation in which you find yourself as you seek out God who is Redeemer. 5 years ago, when Daniel Roof walked into the Mother Emmanuel African Methodist Episcopal Church in Charleston, many members were quick to welcome the stranger, hold hands, and pray with him. But after he shot all 9 of the members in that Bible study that night, in his call for a race war, he remained defiant and unrepentant. He was filled with hatred for African Americans and Christians. While many members of the church were quick to claim their Christian duty, saying they forgave him and prayed for him, the Reverend Waltrina Middleton refused. In this week's Christian Century, she writes that 5 years later, she still can't forgive him for taking her cousin's life. Her grief and lamentation are not finished. Forgiveness early on by the members was perhaps premature, and it gave a false narrative that kept others from acknowledging the deep racial hatred in our country. Reverend Middleton writes that when she wakes up every morning, she is in agony. She still misses her cousin. When she goes to bed every night, she misses her cousin. It's going to be a long time before she gets to the point of forgiveness. Ruth refused to see her cousin as a human being. On the day that George Floyd was killed, a woman was walking her dog in Central Park when a black man calmly asked her to restrain and chain her dog. It's the law of the city. She started screaming, calling the police, accusing the black man of assaulting and attacking her. Mr. Cooper, the black man, recorded it all on his cell phone. Her toxic racial bias was recorded, and it was clear she was distorting the truth. The Manhattan district attorney charged her with filing a false police report. When Mr. Cooper was approached to testify and press charges, he refused. He said, no, he's not going to let this woman's wrong attitudes become a political football or add fuel to the fire. In a Washington Post op-ed, Cooper wrote, "I must err on the side of compassion. It's the only course I can pursue in good conscience." Peter Marty writes, the word conscience comes from the Latin word, which means to know together with. Conscience is not just my own little voice or my interior whisper, but it's something that is a joint and shared knowledge. Justice is always personal. Just as mercy is always personal. There has to be a way for us to go forward together. Is it justice tempered with mercy? Is it reconciliation combined with forgiveness? Inner work combined with interpersonal work? A sense of conscience, a sense of compassion. I like Christian Cooper's words, "I erred on the side of compassion." I believe that Joseph prefigures the work of Jesus Christ as our brother who turns the other cheek and our brother who goes the second mile to show us the unconditional love of God at work in every situation. Through God's act of creation, we are sisters and brothers, and through Christ's act of redemption, we're doubly bound to each other in the bonds of mercy and love. Let's find a way to go forward together. I'm your brother, Joseph. Let's be family again. Amen.
Thank you.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was King of the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Welcome to worship at Second Presbyterian Church, wherever you are this morning. We are blessed by your presence with us. We hold each other in prayer as we walk together through this pandemic and everything else going on. If you need prayer, please call the church office or fill out an online prayer request form. If you need a listening ear, please call the church office. You can also contact us through the online form to receive our monthly newsletter, weekly e-blast, and stay current in all the offerings of our church. With churches, many churches all over the city, we joyfully open our sanctuary for worship beginning September 6th. More details will be coming this week about our inaugural service. If you're watching this morning, we need you to help us continue this ministry with a tangible sign of your support. We're halfway to our goal of paying for our audiovisual equipment and recording our services. For those of you who are members and friends, you know Second Presbyterian is an amazing multicultural congregation, a diverse fellowship that reaches out all over the world. We pray that you'll help us expand our sense of community by increasing our outreach. And as always, we ask you to go online immediately after the service and right-click your link to submit a donation. Your faithful giving and your commitment keep our everyday ministries going forward. And now hear the words of the prophet Micah. What does the Lord require of thee but to do justice, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God? O God, our Redeemer, we praise you. We thank you for your justice and your mercy. We thank you that you are our God and have chosen us to be your people. You've given us your precious Holy Spirit and anointed us with gifts the world cannot give. Keep us faithful and true, Lord, as we worship you in spirit and in truth. These are turbulent times, O God, but we know you are in our midst. We need your word to guide us, your spirit to give us wisdom. This morning we pray for Chicago Public School administrators and teachers. Give our teachers creative ways to reach the students. Give us sound, practical ways to overcome the digital divide. We pray for each student preparing for a new semester. Renew their commitment each day to log in and do their homework. Be with parents and help them keep the faith and hold on to the possibilities they can do with their children. And keep our children and our families safe and healthy. We pray for the city of Chicago. We're aware of so much systematic racism, and we need a change in education and healthcare and government and law, small businesses and employment. God, lift up this city. Lift up our leaders and give them wisdom. Forge new coalitions of people who seek peace and goodwill. For churches and synagogues and temples and mosques, renew our commitments to work for the common good. And now, Lord, we pray for healing. Our family members need cures and healing. Our relationships need restoring and care. Our friends and neighbors need cures and healing. Lord of light, grant your radiant healing touch. And let your gift of abundant life and spiritual vigor and strength be upon all who call upon your name. Now, to sum up our prayers, hear us as we pray the prayer your Son taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. And forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. As God's chosen ones, holy and beloved, clothe yourselves with compassion, bear with one another, and if anyone has a complaint against another, forgive each other. Just as the Lord has forgiven you, so you also must forgive. And above all, clothe yourself with love, which binds everything together in perfect harmony. And let the peace of Christ rule in your hearts, because you were called to be one body. May the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, communion of the Holy Spirit, the companionship of one another, go with you and bless you this week and always.